Buongiorno a tutti, come al solito facciamo il solito test audio, quindi fatemi sapere se mi sentite correttamente. Buongiorno a tutti, come al solito facciamo il solito test audio. Oh, very good, of course. The lecture will be in English. I will not forget. So, while we are waiting, did you make a sort of, let us say, statistics or poll on how many of you experienced the difficulties in the live streaming yesterday? Yes, I know that for several people there were no problem, but I'm interested to know how many people did experience problems. What percentage at least? I think it has to do with the local network, not with my network, which seems to work pretty well. I did also a speed test yesterday, and it was going pretty fast. And also, let us take the opportunity of this time before we start to ask questions. So you can write the questions on the chat. While we are waiting. So you see five people who had problems so far. Not major problems, however, in the sense that you have been able to follow with some difficulty. So I think, Saita, I think it's your connection. It's not because other people are not experiencing any problem. Okay, so there is one question that arrived. There were other by mail that I will address later because they are of general interest. Well, there is always a delay. Since I'm following live on my laptop, I notice that there is a delay of about 60 seconds. So that's unavoidable. Unfortunately. Okay, some problems for some people, but not, I would say, about 7 or 8 people experienced problem yesterday. It will be hard to, I can try to reduce the resolution of my slides. But I'm not convinced I can try to do that perhaps tomorrow. So let us wait another minute and then we will answer questions that came also in the mail. So, good, let's start. And again, good morning to everyone. There is a number of questions on the Kalman filter and also on other topics. For example, I received an email where one of you reported about a discussion that you had about how the weights have to be attributed. So the question was, in a weighted least square problem, do we need to attribute weights after every iteration? Or do we attribute weights at the end by looking at the residuals? Well, the answer is mixed because what I generally do, and there is no single answer, what I generally do, I use weights which are those expected on average conditions for a given station. And they may be wrong by even a factor of two or three, or even more. And I get to convergence. Of course, if we are dealing with a single set of observables and a single station, with weights which are all identical, one can easily attribute the weights at the end, in the final pass, in the final iteration. If not, what I do is to use these conventional values, arrive at convergence, may not be the best convergence value, and then I start changing the weight iteration by iteration. I do another one or two iterations with the proper weights, looking at the residuals, and that will be my final solution and final covariance matrix. But there is not a single answer. Okay, so I hope I answered to the question that came in the mail, but we can talk about it more in detail on Skype. Then there was a question in the chat. One about the last equation that we saw yesterday, the one on PK. Let me, however, before we do that, let me summarize the basics of the Kalman filter. Which steps did we follow? So we started from looking for a minimum variance unbiased estimator that is linear, a linear combination in the new data and the a priori states. This estimator had also the property of being able to process the observations once at a time and provide the state at the time at which the observation was taken. A completely different outcome with respect to the batch filter, where the state is determined at a reference epoch. And then one uses the state transition matrix to propagate forward and backward. Here we want to update the state step by step, every time the observations come in. And we said that the Kalman filter is ideal for real-time applications, for this capability of providing the state immediately after an observation is taken. So we worked out all the machinery of the Kalman filter, and we came up with this very important expression for the estimated state at time tk. And we saw that it's the sum of the propagated state from previous observations, what we call x dash, plus a correction, which is the product by a matrix called Kalman gain matrix and a difference, observed observables minus computed observables. And this difference is called, in the jargon of the Kalman filter, the innovation process. Then we factored in the third requirement, The one about minimum variance, because we required again that this estimator is minimum variance. And with this, with a bit of algebra, matrix algebra, we were able to obtain the Kalman gain matrix, this one here. Okay. I should have circled. Do you see the laser pointer? I hope so. I don't see moving in my replica. Okay, so this is the Kalman gain matrix, and very important also the covariance, the updated covariance, which is a function of the Kalman gain matrix. The covariance is important because the Kalman gain matrix depends on the propagated covariance. This step is called in the jargon of the Kalman filter measurement, the measurement update. The previous one was the time update. So we will comment about the advantages and disadvantages of the Kalman filter, but first let me answer to the many questions that came on the chat. So Giulio Brandizzi, how do we get the last equation, the one on PK? I think you guess this equation here. Okay? So this equation is, there are several ways of deriving this equation, but one of these is to use this equation here. You can derive pk from this equation, or let us go back, even better, this one. Okay? So this equation is, if you replace the Kalman gain matrix in this equation, you obtain exactly what is written here. If you are not convinced, you can simply consider the following. Try replacing d in this equation and work out all the details. You will necessarily get the expression that we saw, this one. Let me see if there is another even simpler expression for the Kalman gain matrix, which is this one, is the one in the red box up here. You have only to make the effort to put in this equation the Kalman gain matrix that we have found. Okay, and you can do using d to the minus one, which makes everything simpler, because for example, you see here k d to the minus one d, this is a unit matrix. and you get rid of it, and so on. So you have to work out a bit the algebra, and I encourage you to do it yourself. There is nothing profound in all this algebra. And remember that at the exam, during the exam, I will not ask you to derive these equations from scratch. I will ask you to comment on the slide. So the derivation will be simply commenting on the slides, with a few exceptions, with a few exceptions of very basic things. Then another question. One. When we diagonalize, this has nothing to do with the Kalman filter, but with the statistics. When we diagonalize the covariance matrix, we have two variables which are uncorrelated or independent. Well, if the variables are normally distributed, it can be shown that the concept, if two variables are uncorrelated, they are also independent. But remember, this is true only for normal distributions. So, lack of correlation means that they are also independent. And you could see it because when the correlation coefficient rho in the probability density function is equal to zero, you can factorize the exponential in the product of two exponential, one where appears x squared, the other y squared, and therefore the joint probability density function is also the product of the two individual probability density function, which is the sign that the variables are independent, statistically independent. But remember, this is only true for normally distributed variables. It's the only case where lack of correlation, no correlation, implies independence. Please write on the chat and let me know whether the answer was satisfactory. Then I have another question. Oh, yes, from the same person. The average that we made on the covariance matrix in the Kalman filter requires that the mixed term, off diagonal term, are null, are zero, because the noise epsilon is zero mean. I'm not sure I really understand this question, but probably you refer to this particular case when we take the average of things which, for example, here you have k epsilon multiplied by I multiplied by this difference x dash minus x. Well, that is zero, because everything is deterministic except epsilon, the errors. And the average of and the average of epsilon is equal to zero. Okay? So the average of epsilon is equal to zero, and so that term is equal to zero. So I see many problems with the streaming. Let me check if I can do something by reducing the frame rate. Okay, wait a moment. So I'm looking at the scene transition. What can I play with? So now I have increased the duration of the frame to 400 milliseconds in order to send fewer frames. Probably I hope that the network is not saturated, because here locally I have no problem at all. There is a number of parameters. Microsoft Teams has given a lot of problems, unfortunately. So anyway, the only thing that I made is to increase the frame duration to 400, the update rate to 400 milliseconds. I can do it even 500 milliseconds and see whether the situation improves or not. It's better now. Let me see. Let us return to the slides. Okay, let us continue in this way. So I lost the question. And because the chat was full of people complaining. So the average operation on the covariance matrix requires that the mixed terms are zero because epsilon is zero mean. Yes, when epsilon is zero mean, of course, every time one sees epsilon alone, appearing alone in an expression, since the average is zero, all the term goes to zero. This is certainly not true when you look at the covariance, epsilon, epsilon transpose. Okay? This and this. Then let me see if there are other questions. No. All right, let us continue, therefore, with the lecture. And so what are the weaknesses and the strength of a Kalman filter? Well, you can see here the strengths are immediate. First of all, you can process time observations once at a time, and therefore you are not forced to work with large matrices. If we go back here, the matrix H tilde is very small, because it's a matrix which, if there is only one observation, contains only one line and a number of columns which is equal to the number of the state vectors, the number of elements of the state vectors. So computationally, much easier. And also this quantity, the covariance of the noise, if you have a single observation, remember that this is a single number. A single number. And the same is true, of course, of all these parts. This collapses to a single number. So you have not to invert a large matrix. You have to take simply the reciprocal of this quantity, H tilde P H tilde transpose plus RK. So computationally, incredibly easier. However, especially in orbit determination problem, there are some limitations. First, it works very well in linear or weakly nonlinear problems. We will see tomorrow the spring mass problem solved with the Kalman filter instead that with the batch filter. And tomorrow we will do another important exercise, because we will introduce the solution of a more realistic problem. And the more realistic problem is a satellite orbiting a planet. And we will see how we can determine the orbit of a satellite orbiting a planet whose gravity field is modeled as a point, essentially as a point mass, only the GM. There is no J2. There are no higher order, higher degree harmonics. The Kalman filter that we saw has very poor performances in non-linear problems, strongly non-linear problems. And unfortunately, OD, orbit determination, falls in this category. The other drawback is that if the putative state, the state from which we start, let us say the reference trajectory, is not close to the true state, it's easy to diverge, and the Kalman filter will never be able to go back to the or close to the real state. The third point we will see later is very, very serious, because the covariance matrix elements tend to zero when a large number of observations is processed. When there are many observations, the covariance matrix tend to zero, and the Kalman filter becomes essentially insensitive to new observations. The gain matrix becomes extremely small, and therefore new observations are not providing any change in the state, or they cannot provide any change in the state. And also numerical problems may occur. The covariance matrix, as computed according to the formula that we have seen earlier, may lose a fundamental property, the property of being positive definite. And when the covariance matrix starts getting negative eigenvalues, then the Kalman filter goes belly up and stops working. However, there are reasonable cures for many of these problems. The most important one is another version of the Kalman filter, which is called the extended Kalman filter, which solves, at least in part, the problem of the nonlinearity. But first, let us see what are... this is, I'm not sure that this is the slide that I want to project, because I modified it, but it works anyway. So this is a demo. This is to show you that the covariance matrix tends to zero when we process a large number of observations. So we have seen that the covariance matrix at time tk is made up by these terms. Okay, so we have the covariance matrix propagated forward, the Kalman gain matrix, the usual H tilde, and again the covariance matrix propagated forward. So, what is plotted on this axis is the trace of the covariance matrix pk. So, let us start from a time t0. As time progresses, and we propagate forward the covariance matrix according to this formula, okay, the trace in general will increase. The estimate of the state degrades when we are lacking observations. Then the new observations come in, and the covariance matrix is decreased from this value is pk, is decreased by this factor k h tilde transpose p. So it goes down. And then we propagate forward at time t2, it starts increasing again. And then is reduced forward by this factor, k2 h tilde, there is a transpose missing here, I think, but I'm not sure, there may be a mistake here, no, there must be a transpose here, is decreased by this factor. Let me check one moment. No. There is no transpose. So here I made a mistake. There is no transpose here. Okay? No transpose. Let me wait one moment for... okay, you see here. When I move the pointer, do you see it moving or not? Yes, it moves. So this is, there is no transpose here, it's a mistake. So anyway, the covariance matrix is continuously decreased at every step and approaches a value that is close to zero. What is plotted there is the trace on the covariance matrix. Now, you may remember that the covariance matrix defines the Kalman gain matrix. So the Kalman gain matrix, which is here, depends on the propagation of the covariance matrix. If this covariance matrix becomes small, then the entire Kalman gain matrix tends to go to zero, becomes very small. And therefore, in the equation for the estimator, the new observation have very little weight. They don't do much because the Kalman gain matrix is small. One of the cures of this problem, for example, is to add artificially noise or to restart the integration when the Kalman gain matrix becomes too small. Okay, these are tricks that are put in place to avoid this important problem. But much more frequently used, a flavor of the Kalman filter, which is called the extended Kalman filter. And the extended Kalman filter, in a sense, is easier to implement than the previous one, than the standard Kalman filter. Why? Because in the Kalman filter, if you remember, we had a reference trajectory and we computed variations always with respect to the reference trajectory. And the reference trajectory may deviate even significantly from the true state. In the extended Kalman filter, what one does is to assume a new reference trajectory every time a new value of the state is obtained. So, for example, suppose that we have processed observation at time tk. We have obtained a new state at time tk, and what we do is to restart the integration of the reference trajectory on the state, on the newly determined state. We start from there. We abandon the previous reference trajectory and generate a new one based on the new state that we have determined. Okay, so this is the fundamental difference. We abandon the reference trajectory. Every time we process a new observation, we produce a new reference trajectory. However, we need not to produce the full reference trajectory. We simply adopt the new value as a starting point. For example, look here. Suppose that we have determined after processing the observation at time tk a new state deviation vector xk. We sum it to the old reference trajectory, which is this, and obtain a new estimate of the state, which is this one. Okay? This is our new starting point. And we reinitialize all the machinery of the Kalman filter starting from this new point. Of course, if we start from this new point, the new state deviation xk is now zero. Okay, because we restart the integration. And we are on the new reference trajectory. Whenever we are on the new reference trajectory, the state deviation is zero. Therefore, since even x dash at time k, tk plus 1 is obtained by propagating forward this state, this is zero, multiply it by the state transition matrix, the new one, it's always zero. So also xk plus 1 propagated forward is equal to zero. And the expression for the Kalman filter simplifies incredibly because x estimated at time k plus 1 is equal to this term, which we see is zero. So this goes away. Also this term goes away, h tilde x dash k plus 1. And we are left simply with the Kalman gain matrix at time k plus 1 multiplied by the new observation at time k plus 1. So the filter, the extended Kalman filter, is even simpler to implement. And you see immediately that the state covariance matrix is not needed to propagate forward the trajectory, but only to propagate forward the covariance matrix, because the Kalman gain matrix requires, is built on the propagated covariance matrix. Let us go back here. You see? Just a moment, a few moments of delay. Just one moment, I'm looking on the screen. Yes. You see, the Kalman gain matrix depends on the propagated covariance matrix. So the state transition matrix that is not useful to propagate the state forward, because x dash k plus 1 will always be 0, but this is not true for p dash k plus 1. And the reason why we need it is because we need to propagate forward the state covariance matrix in order to get the Kalman gain matrix. Okay, so let us go back. There is a question. So if we have x dash equal to zero, we don't have an a priori information. The a priori information is contained already in the fact that x dash is equal to zero, because we are on the new trajectory. So the a priori information is implicitly included in the condition x dash is equal to zero. So it's not true that we are losing the a priori information. No, the a priori information is there, because the fact that you have x dash equal to zero comes from all the previous observations done even prior to the observation at time tk. Okay, so it's implicitly included. And this is the Kalman filter, the extended Kalman filter. Very simple and more powerful than the standard Kalman filter. The advantages, let me see how we are doing. We have 3 minutes only. The extended Kalman filter has advantages. Convergence is generally faster because we are staying closer to the true trajectory. We change the reference trajectory at every time. And we already said that we don't need to map the state deviation, but only the covariance matrix. There are drawbacks. One is that we need to reinitialize the numerical process at every step. In modern computers, which are very fast, this is definitely not a problem, is no longer a problem. However, one important thing, I strongly advise against using the extended Kalman filter at t equals zero at the beginning, because this may introduce instabilities. It's better to start with a regular Kalman filter for a few steps and then move to the extended Kalman filter to avoid these instabilities. Because if the noise in the observation, for example, is too large, it's very easy to obtain large deviations from the true trajectory. And therefore, the catching, locking onto the true trajectory may be complicated. Okay, now it's 10:59. I think we can stop here. We will look at an example. So we'll reconvene at 11:15. And in the meanwhile, let me know first if the connection went better. I didn't see any complaint on the chat. And also, if you want, write questions on the chat. Okay, so let me know if there are questions. I will take a short break and come back. Okay, let's restart. So I didn't see any question on the chat for what we saw. Now I want to follow a very, very simple example that you find also on the textbook, on Tapley's textbook. It may look very simple, elementary, but I think it's instructive. And essentially, this example shows how a very simple problem where we have a state, where we have a state with two variables, so the state vector is made up by only two variables, x1 and x2, with a fixed state transition matrix, which is this very simple matrix, 1, 1, 0, 1. And with this, let us say, dynamical equations, we use observations, just one additional observation, which comes at time t1, okay, which is made up by two variables. One could be range, the other range rate, with these values, 6, 4. And we have noise in these observations, and the noise covariance matrix, which is the inverse of the weight matrix in the minimum variance estimator, or in the weighted least square estimator, is equal to epsilon epsilon transpose, and is diagonal. So the first observation, y1, has noise equal to 2, the second one noise equal to 3/4, and is diagonal. We write here the observation state equation. So we have the matrix H tilde. The matrix H tilde is this one, 0, 1, 1 half, 1 half. Okay. And this is the equation which connects the observation to the state. The goal is to find the best estimate of the state at time t0 using the batch processor, and the best estimate of the state x at time t1, so at the second time, using the sequential processor, the Kalman filter. And then we want to compare the two covariance matrices at time t1. So the idea is, if we propagate forward the covariance matrix obtained by solving problem 1, we should obtain, we must obtain, the same covariance matrix obtained by the Kalman filter. And we will see that this is actually true. There is one additional piece of information. We are using also an initial, an a priori covariance matrix, which is this, at time t0, and an a priori state at time t0, which is 3 over 2. This a priori state, de facto, for us, is the initial state. Okay? So we want to solve this simple linear problem in two ways. And we will do a number of matrix multiplication with numbers. So let us find the best estimate of x at time t0 with the batch processor. We have the state transition matrix. We have the matrix H tilde. We have the a priori covariance matrix. We have the a priori state, which is this one. And we have the observations at time t1. Finally, we have the noise covariance matrix, we have seen 2 3/4 diagonal. Now, what do we have to do? Just apply the formulas, period. And the formula for the minimum variance estimator with a priori information is given by the famous formula that we have seen. So we have the a priori information matrix, this. We have the usual part, which comes from the observation. You see that all this is very simple. And then we have this additional term. Now, in the in the minimum variance estimator, in order to have the matrix, we have to use the matrix H, H1, not the matrix H tilde. Okay, if you remember, because we want to refer everything to the initial state at time t0. Therefore, we have to obtain the matrix H1 by multiplying H tilde at time t1 by the state transition matrix. And this is, these indexes are, actually I should have written t0, t1. So, this is the matrix H tilde, which is written here. This is the matrix, the state transition matrix. I carry out the multiplication. We don't do the computation. Very easily, one obtains this matrix H1. So this is the matrix H1, which you see is different from the matrix H tilde. We have one here. Then let's move forward. We have to compute all the various pieces. So, t0 to the minus 1, this is the a priori covariance matrix. And the a priori covariance matrix, if you remember, let's go back, the a priori covariance matrix here is this identity matrix. Okay? So, let us go back. A priori, H transpose, we take the transpose of it, we take the weight matrix, which is, remember, the weight matrix is the inverse of, it's here. Okay, this is W to the minus 1, the covariance matrix. We have to take the inverse of this. So, here, we have one half and four third. And then H1, the matrix H1. And everything to, we have to take the inverse of this matrix here. And then we have the second term, this one. Let me use perhaps the pen. So we are now addressing our attention to this term. This is nothing but this. And again, you see H tilde WY, H tilde, sorry, not H tilde, H transpose, which is this matrix here. Then we have the weight matrix, then the observations, and then the a priori state, which was 3-2, multiplied by the inverse of the a priori covariance matrix. But the a priori covariance matrix, if you remember, it was the identity matrix. So here there was the identity matrix in front, which is missing. So we carry out all the computation. We don't do all of them, but we end up, you see, with this matrix to be inverted times this part here. So this is this. And this one to the minus one is this. Okay? So if we carry out the computation, it's not something that we will do, but we end up with this final solution. X1 is equal to 11/4/3, and this is the associated covariance matrix. Again, connection problems. Unfortunately, at this point, I cannot, I don't know what to do. It seems that are always the same people with connection problems. So I will try to go slower, but there is nothing I can do. The important thing is that the videos are available without any problem online after the class is over. So you will have the possibility to listen at this lecture again offline, and also follow the suggestions that some of your colleagues are giving on the chat. If we write the covariance matrix that we obtained at time t0 in terms of correlations and covariances, we see that these are the numbers that we get. Okay? These are the numbers that we get. There is a negative correlation coefficient between state x1 and state x2. Just to start with. All right. So this is the sequential estimation. Batch estimation, minimum variance estimation. Now we want to use the machinery of the Kalman filter. So the equations, covariance matrix, a priori covariances, everything is the same. In order to estimate the state at time t1, we have to propagate forward the state at time t0, obtain the Kalman gain matrix, which is in this yellow box, and then compute the innovation. And this is it. So the first step is propagating forward the state from x0 to x1. We obtain x1 dash by multiplying the state x0 times the state transition matrix, and we find 5 over 2. Okay, this is the state propagated forward. It's different from the true state because we have not factored in the observation coming at time t1. The state that we have found with the, in this case, with the batch processor would be this. And if you multiply this state by the state transition matrix to obtain the state at time t1, you would get a number, a matrix, which is different from 5 over 2, for sure. So this, remember, is the propagated state. Then we have to propagate forward the state covariance matrix. So we start from the a priori state covariance matrix, which luckily is diagonal. Let me take the pen. So this. Is P0. And this multiplication is very simple because we get this result. So this is P dash, the propagated covariance at time t1. Then we have to start computing the Kalman gain matrix, and we'll do it piece by piece. So laser pointer, we have to compute P dash X tilde, H tilde. P dash, which is what we just obtained, times H tilde, which is this quantity that we have. Okay? H tilde was provided at the very beginning. Let us go back. Where is H tilde? Okay, here it is. Observation state equation. This is H tilde. At time 1. At time t1. Okay? let us return here. We have the matrix H tilde, this is H tilde transpose, we have to take the transpose of it and obtain this matrix. Then we have to compute what is in the brackets. And this is what we are doing here. We have to compute H tilde P dash H tilde transpose. So H tilde P dash H tilde transpose. We take advantage of the fact that we computed already P H tilde transpose, which is this value. P dash H tilde transpose, which is this. Pen. This is that we computed, and H1 is tilde is this matrix. All right. So we have to sum, however, the information matrix, the weight matrix, the covariance matrix of the noise, to the minus 1, so it's again 2, 3 over 4, 0, 0. We sum the outcome of this multiplication, which is this. We take the inverse of this matrix, and we end up with this matrix here. So this matrix is this matrix here. Okay, these two are the same thing. And we have to multiply by P dash H tilde transpose, something that we computed already, which is this matrix here. So once we do the multiplication, we obtain the Kalman gain. And this is the Kalman gain. Okay? This is the Kalman gain matrix. Now we are ready to use the full machinery of the Kalman estimation formula, which, remember, is propagated state times the Kalman gain matrix multiplied by the innovation. Observed observables, new observations, minus predicted observations. We have all the matrices, 5 over 2. This is the Kalman gain matrix. If we do the multiplication, all this matrix multiplication inside, we obtain 4 over 1 half. And therefore, we are ready to estimate the new state, which is this guy here, 23 over 4 over 3. We can compute, very important, the associated covariance matrix at time t1 using this formula. So, identity matrix times the Kalman gain matrix multiplied by H tilde, which is something that we computed already. We computed already this quantity here. Or if we don't, I don't remember if we computed already. No, we didn't. We didn't compute. So you have to believe me that this is the right result. So this is Kalman gate matrix times h tilde at time t1. Boy. And then we multiply by the propagated state covariance, which is this. Okay, this is the propagated state covariance. And if we carry out the computation patiently, we get this number. Okay, so these are state and covariance at time t1. In the minimum variance estimator, we obtained state and covariance at time t0. Okay? We want to compare the two results and see whether by propagating forward state and covariance obtained from the minimum variance estimator at time t0, we really obtain the results, the same result as the Kalman filter. So, we take x0, 11 over 4 over 3, multiplied by the state transition matrix, and we obtain 23 over 4 divided by 3. Not surprisingly, this quantity, remember, 23 over 4 divided by over 3 is identical to the state that was determined with the Kalman filter. Okay? So we are on the right track. And same thing for the state covariance. If we propagate, there is a mistake here. This must be zero. Okay, P0. If we propagate forward P0 to time T1 with the state transition matrix using this formula, we work out all the arithmetics and we obtain, not surprisingly, a state covariance matrix at time T1, which, remember, is 1/5 17 over 20, 17 over 20, 17 over 20, I need to use the laser pointer, 17 over 20, 1/5, 1/5, and 2/5. So, exactly the same result. In this simple linear problem, the Kalman filter and the minimum variance estimator provide the same result. But remember, this is not true in general. It's true in this simple problem. It's also true that the two estimates cannot be too different. And if things are done properly with the Kalman filter, especially the extended Kalman filter, the result obtained from the minimum variance estimator and the one from the Kalman extended Kalman filter are very, very close and statistically equivalent. Okay, so this is an important result. There are questions. There is a question. Sigma x1 and sigma x2 in the minimum variance estimator were the standard deviation in the previous page. Sigma x1 and sigma x2. You mean here? So this is a different way to rewrite the covariance matrix by using variances of the by using variances normalized variances. Okay, and let me think how this is obtained. I don't remember exactly. I have to come back to you to explain the numerical values and how this is obtained. But these are the, if you take the square root of 17 over 20, so this is not a covariance matrix. If you take the square root of 17 over 20, let me check. Square root, you obtain exactly this number. So this is the sigma, it's not the sigma square. In the covariance matrix, the diagonal contain the variances, the sigma squares. If you take the square root of the sigmas, you obtain these numbers. So this is the uncertainty in the variable x1 and the uncertainty in the variable x2. And this is simply the square root of 1/5. Let me check. 0.2 square root. No, this is something different. This is the correlation coefficient between the two variables. So is this value, okay, divided by sigma 1 and sigma 2, everything divided by sigma 1 and sigma 2. That should be it. But I will answer, and I will add something here, some further explanation on this equation. Okay? Sorry for that. So we have obtained these important results, and Tapley gives you an algorithm for the Kalman filter and the extended Kalman filter that you can see reported here in these slides. So let us go through together in these 10 minutes on the algorithm for the Kalman filter and the extended Kalman filter. So in the Kalman filter, we have initialized everything at T0. We set I, the first point, equal to 1. We set the value of t equal to t0, a sort of initial epoch. We have a reference trajectory x star at time t0. And since we don't have any preceding information, the sequential filter must assumes that you have observation, earlier observations. In this case, when you start, you don't have any initial information, so you have no estimated state at time minus one. You set that the initial time, the previous observation, is equal to x0 dash. Okay? the X0 dash comes from a priori information and in general from the reference trajectory. Same is true for the a priori covariance matrix. One has to invent an a priori covariance matrix at time t0, something that is used to start with. Okay, imagine we have no data at this point and we have to start. Then the first observation comes in at time, let us say, ti. The observation is yi. Notice the capital letter and the covariance of the noise at time ti. You may wonder, but how can I know the covariance of the noise at time at the next time ti, t1? After all, I have only one number, I don't have any statistics. Then this means that you have to rely on some a priori information about the statistic and the covariance of the noise. You can do better later. Then, next steps. We integrate the reference trajectory and the state transition matrix from ti minus 1 to ti using the state transition matrix. So we have to integrate the equation of motion, which are this, with the initial condition starting from coming from the reference trajectory. We construct we consider these equations, the equation of motion. The equation of motion are simplified, linearized by producing the matrix A, the dynamical matrix, which is the partial derivatives of F, the forces with respect to the state vector along the reference trajectory. And we solve the variational equations, the equation for the state transition matrix in the linearized problem, which we know very well is equal to this. Which are the initial conditions? Again, the transition state transition matrix at time t minus 1 is equal to the identity matrix. So we obtain the reference trajectory by integrating the variational equation and propagating forward the initial state, and get, of course, the state transition matrix. Then we do the first step, the so-called time update. The time update assumes that we take the estimated state at time I minus 1 and propagate it forward to time ti to obtain x dash I. Same thing for the state covariance matrix. Then let us turn our attention to the observations and the observation deviations, the lowercase y, which are uppercase y minus the computed observables, g computed along the reference trajectory at time ti. We compute the matrix h tilde at time ti, which is the partial derivative of the observation equation with respect to the state along the reference trajectory, asterisk, and we compute the Kalman gain matrix. We have all the elements now to compute the Kalman gain matrix. And at this point, we are ready to carry out the measurement update, applying the formula for the state estimation according to the Kalman filter. And the formula, we have seen it already many times. So this is the estimate of the state at time ti. Once we process the observation y lowercase y I, and we also obtain the new covariance matrix, pi. And then everything restarts. We set I equal to I plus 1, and therefore we restart all the steps that we have done using ti as initial time. Our goal is to obtain the state at time ti plus 1, and so forth. All right, so this is the machinery of the standard Kalman filter. What is the difference with this is taken verbatim from Tapley. What is the difference with the extended Kalman filter? Well, we initialize everything again at time t0. We don't have preceding values, so the initial steps are identical. We read the next observation, so we have ti, yi, and ri, identical to the previous case. We integrate the reference trajectory and state transition matrix from the ti minus 1, there is a mistake here, to ti. These are the dynamical equations with the initial conditions on the reference trajectory at time ti minus 1. We again obtain the dynamical matrix A. We again solve the variational equation and obtain the state transition matrix. Remember that the state transition matrix is necessary in the Kalman filter, extended Kalman filter, only to propagate forward the covariance matrix, but not the state. And so we obtain x star at time e and the state transition matrix. So we are ready to do the time update. The time update now implies only the propagation of the state covariance matrix. There is no need to propagate the state because the x dash will be equal to zero. We know it already. Okay? Here in the standard Kalman filter, the time update requires also propagating forward the state. But in the extended Kalman filter, since we are continuously updating the reference trajectory, x dash is always equal to zero. And so there is no way, no reason to propagate it forward. So the time update entails only the propagation of the covariance matrix through the state transition matrix. And here we are done. We do the same thing as this step is identical to the one that we had for the standard Kalman filter. We obtain h tilde, we obtain lowercase y, we obtain the Kalman gain matrix, which is identical to the previous one. But in order to do the measurement update, we have to do this very simple step. The updated state at time ti is equal simply to the Kalman gain matrix at time ti multiplied by the new observations, period. And then we can update the reference trajectory. So we add to the previous reference trajectory, we add this term and obtain a new reference trajectory. We propagate forward the covariance matrix, which is this. Okay. And we restart the process again. So we are at the end of this lecture. Tomorrow we will meet still on YouTube, because we will provide you, we will do two things. One is to solve the spring mass problem with the Kalman filter. And second, we will give you the elements to solve a more realistic problem, finally, of a satellite orbiting a planet. Okay, so we will use the full Newton's law. We will use, we will set a ground antenna, place a ground antenna on the Earth or any other planet, provide observables, and we will determine the orbit, a real orbit of a satellite using this time the minimum variance estimator. We will redo it also for the Kalman filter. Okay? So this is all for today, and again, I stay here for another 5 minutes to know whether there are questions. And then the appointment is for tomorrow at noon. Tomorrow noon. Okay, if there are no other questions, I would stop streaming. And again, remember that I'm available to give answer or explanations by email or on Skype. Okay, goodbye to everyone.